And the thing is, she never reaches 20 because the bass always increases by 3.
Doesn't sound like a children's book.
It doesn't, right?
Ah, Jonas, mm-hmm. Do you have a minute?
Of course.
There are no 2 free seats in the student lab. Let me show you.
Oh, nice.
I gotta go. Bye.
Okay, bye.
Bye. Everywhere, most of the time we're unaware, but horses know we're leaking all the time. When looking in the fridge, when coffin does the bidding bridge, your sardinals for fun and for the prize, cause sardinals are with us all the time. Oh, I know that error. Oh, I'm Irene, hi.
Hi, Jonas.
Yeah, I think I had the same problem with my laptop. It turned out that the DRAM was not recognized by the BIOS anymore.
Mm-hmm.
We could just open it and check what's wrong.
Okay, sounds good. That was easy. So, here's the DRAM. You know, it's really fascinating how in C an access to a pointer or array goes directly to one of those chips.
Well, that's a very simplified view, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's what we teach the students in the first semesters. The RAM is basically the main memory. You can think of it like a huge array, and a pointer is just a number, an index in that array.
That's not simplifying, that's just wrong.
Is this the operating system lecture now?
Yes, Paul, you're right, because actually there is virtual memory.
Yeah, virtual memory, a very powerful concept.
Yeah, so basically it is just one layer of indirection, a single map. So you want your separate virtual address space for each process, and the physical address space...
The physical address space contains all kinds of things. There's, for example, various memory mapped devices, BIOS registers, or the DRAM.
Yeah, so basically all the things the programmer doesn't want to care about.
Yes, exactly. So the programmer doesn't want to care about things which are in DRAM and where in DRAM.
Ah, and that's why we have virtual address space per process.
Yeah, exactly. You basically have a map where you translate your virtual addresses to the physical ones.
Mm-hmm. And a pointer? That's just a number, or not?
No, it's a struct.
Yeah,
what?
Like,
think about it. So if you have 64 gigabyte of virtual address space and you want to map each byte to a byte in a physical address space, let's say it is also 64 gigabyte, how would you do that?
Are you suggesting an entry in a map or something for every byte?
Yeah, that's a good idea, but that would be way too expensive. Will you instead group together many bytes to pages and say that's the smallest unit we can handle?
The size of this block, the so-called page size, is a design choice. And x86 and ARM have both focused on 4 kilobyte pages for many years. So 4 kilobyte pages, they are often the smallest unit that you can handle.
The map from virtual to physical memory, they're called page tables, has also to be stored in the physical memory, and it's super, super convenient to just put them into a size of also a page.
So 4 kilobytes.
Yeah, exactly. And then you can just allocate one block, a page, for each of these page tables.
Okay, but 4 kilobytes cannot fit all the mappings for the virtual memory of one process.
Exactly, and that's why we have a tree of page tables.
Mm-hmm. That sounds like a nice design.
Oh yeah, it absolutely is. We just have one question left to answer here. What is the size of a page table entry? So you want to map a 4 kilobyte block from virtual to physical.
But doesn't that depend on the size of the physical address space?
Yeah, exactly, it does. So in the entry, you want to store the physical starting address of a virtual block. Well, usually a line, so you can save a few bits, but you will need these bits again to store some metadata.
The size of the physical address space has to be larger than the amount of memory in the RAM. Why? Because of all the things we've got in there and want to address. So a convenient size on today's CPUs is at about 2 to the power of 46 bytes, or also maybe 2 to the power of 48 bytes on some other CPUs.
Okay, so if I have, for example, 64 gigabytes of memory, my physical address space would need to have at least 36-bit addresses.
Yes, and so what would be a good entry size?
Yeah. And here the typical design choice would be a power of 2 entry size, because that fits nicely on a 4 kilobyte page then.
36 bits is more than 4 bytes, so we round up to 8 bytes?
Yeah, exactly. So we have 64 bits of storage per page table entry.
So then we have 512 page table entries per page.
Exactly. And that gets us back to our struct.
Yeah, so that's 12-bit page offset.
512 entries in the first page table level.
And that gives us a 9-bit index for the first page table level.
And then we continue with another 9 bits, another 9 bits, another 9 bits, until we reach our 48 bits.
48 bits?
Yeah, that's because our modern 64-bit processors largely still work on 48-bit virtual address space.
Well, some actually also support 57-bit, so that would be one layer more.
Okay. So virtual memory and physical memory is one abstraction layer we have here. Anything else one should know about?
Well, let me think. Yes, actually, there is a cache between the processor and the DRAM.
We ran some flush and reload attacks, but why does the cache allow this?
Yeah, the cache, it just caches everything. Actually, we have different levels of caches, okay? So we've got L1, L2 and L3 cache, for example.
Yeah, but let's say we would just very naively build a super simple cache. It could work like this. So you take the address and you use the lower part to compute a cache index. And you use the upper part to compute the tag, which tells us if we got the right data.
Yes, and with every access, we check the tag if it's in the cache, our data we want. And if it's not in there, we evict whatever is in there. And of course, what is evicted, we write back to the DRAM and load our data we want into the cache.
Well, what? But that design is really bad, because if you access multiple addresses with the same index, you would evict each other all the time, right?
Yeah.
And that's why we just add the concept of sets. So sets are multiple locations that are equally fine to place data in.
Okay, and the cache index now maps to a set and not a single cache line.
Yeah, exactly. And then between these locations, there needs to be some replacement policy. Actually, we call these locations cache ways. So the replacement policy decides which way is used when we load the data.
You didn't specify whether the address there is virtual or physical, but that actually makes an important difference.
Yes. Multiple processes can have different data on the same virtual address. And tags based on virtual addresses are really, really bad because they are ambiguous.
But physical addresses have to be computed first, right? So physical tags are really slow.
But at least they're unique.
Yeah.
Physical tags are slow but unique.
But what about the indices?
Well, with the indices, physical ones are slow and virtual ones are fast.
And this can be a very nice design. Virtual indices but physical tags.
So you can start the lookup right away, and the tags will be ready when you need them.
Yes, L2 and L3 caches use physical addresses because the latency budgets allow that there.
Yes, but in L1 caches. So in L1 caches you have virtual index, physical tag because of performance reasons. But there is one limitation, actually.
It becomes ambiguous, right? Because if I have 64-byte cache lines, that's 2 to the power of 6, so 6 bits for that. And I only have 12-bit virtual page offset, So I can only have 64 cache indices, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, and it's also the number of ways it is very expensive to increase. So you would have to check them all in parallel, and it produces a lot of heat and needs way too much power. So yeah, it is way too much. 8 ways would be doable. We rarely see more than 8 ways in L1 caches.
Okay, so with 8 ways, 64 byte cache lines and 64 cache sets, we are limited to 8 times 64 times 64, that's 32 kilobytes.
Yes, and that's exactly the L1 cache size we've seen in x86 processors for several years now.
Mm. Yes, and this size is the page size times 8 for the 8 way.
Yes, and as the cache uses physical addresses, the shared memory actually maps addresses in different contexts to the same physical address. So the shared memory is shared in the cache.
Ah. So this means if I access a shared memory page, it's stored in the cache. And if another process also accesses the same page, it's already cached, and vice versa. And I can also flush my own addresses from the cache, and they also get flushed for the other processes. That's why all our flush and reload attacks work.
Yes!
Okay. But how do you then determine what goes where in the cache and the DRAM?
Oh, mapping functions.
Yeah, so we had the mapping function from virtual addresses to physical addresses. This one is software controlled by our page tables.
Yes, and then we have the mapping from virtual addresses to the L1 cache. And for the L2 cache, we just use some bits of the physical address.
And then there's the last level cache, usually the largest cache. In some designs, it's called the L3 cache. But it's more complicated, actually.
Yeah, and that can be really annoying when you're building cache side channel attacks.
Yeah, often you talk about two properties, shared and inclusive.
Yeah, so here the protagonist should first talk about shared.
So L1 and L2 caches are usually private caches, which mean they are not shared across cores. But if you have two workloads who run after each other.
Ah, what if the processor is hyperthreading or SMT? But two processes can run on the same core at the same time.
Yeah, in this case, then you still share cache lines.
Yes, and then the second important property is called inclusive. So take two cache layers, let's say L1 and L3. Then L3 can be inclusive to L1, and that means that all the lines in L1 must also be there in L3.
And if you evict the cache line from L3, it must also be evicted from all private L1 caches.
Absolutely.
So also from the L1 cache of another core?
Yes, indeed.
There are also exclusive caches.
Ah, so exclusive means that if the line is, for example, in the level 1 cache, it cannot be in level 3 cache.
Mm-hmm. And then there is also non-inclusive, which basically means anything can happen.
Okay.
On Intel CPUs, you have the last level cache, the L3 cache, which is usually inclusive towards the lower level caches, L1 and L2. So on recent AMD CPUs, this is different, however, because there is an L3 cache as well, but it consists of multiple independent caches, cache blocks, per core complex. And this is just a group of processor cores grouped together.
Yeah, but still, on Z1 core complex, flush and reload would still work.
Yeah, so you would suggest we can stop flush and reload attacks by scheduling threads from different security contexts to different core complexes.
Basically, yes.
But you shouldn't rely on the solution to make software such and secure is still constant time code.
Yeah.
So Intel CPUs have so-called slices in a last level cache.
Mm-hmm.
There are several smaller caches that work together as one big cache. But every core can still more or less access all the other slices directly.
Yeah. But they still operate independently.
Exactly. So there's one slice per core, or on some CPUs, there seem to be two slices per core. And while these slices belong to a core, an important property of this design is that there is a slice function that assigns physical addresses to these slices, independent of the core.
Okay, but then which slice is used just depends on the address and not the core.
And this has a lot of advantages, because think about it, now every address will only be a single time in the L3 cache. So coherence, cache coherence becomes much easier.
So what does this slice function look like?
So there have been multiple reverse engineering works, in particular one by Clementine Maurice et al. And that is particularly relevant because she was the first to reverse engineer the slices on Intel processors. And these are the functions that she found.
But how do you find those functions?
That's actually quite straightforward. One way, performance counters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's actually the way that Clementine Maurice used.
Exactly. There are multiple counters for each slice, and you use flush and reload on one address and see which counter increments.
Mm.
But that doesn't tell me the function, right?
The trick is to run through all the output bits, right? Let's say you have multiple bits, like slices from 0 to 3, then you have 2 bits, slices from 0 to 7, you have 3 bits, and so on. So you go through these slice bits one by one.
So you can just go over the physical address bitwise and flip each individual bit and see if it has an influence on the slice.
Ah, and if it does?
Then you have a list with all the bits that influence the slice function.
Ah, there's the XOR.
Exactly.
There's actually some more background on this, but the interesting part that I would say is still unmentioned here is that the timing of the flush instruction also varies depending on the slice.
We will talk about flush and flush in the next episode.
Yep.
I don't want to ruin your interesting debate here, but there's no way we can fit all of this into one episode.
Well, if they can run it on 50% speed, maybe.
Wow, that sounds really complicated.
Irene, it's getting late.
Yeah, thanks for your help with the laptop and the explanation.
Well, sure thing. See you around.
See you.
Bye.
Bye.
I think that's something really big.
It works.
I think we should send a mail to someone.
An email to someone? Did I miss anything?